Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Good evening. Welcome to Pro-Life Berks. I'm Kathy Kuhns, and my co-host all the way on the left is Carolyn Bonkoski. Hi. The topic of our program this evening is adoption. And we have delightful guests, which Carolyn will introduce them shortly. I would just like to, I have three items here I'd like to mention before we get started, because sometimes we get to talking and we don't have time at the end. But first of all, we're waiting for Senate Bill 3 to be voted on in the House. We thought maybe they'd vote on it today, but we haven't heard anything, so it's not going to be till tomorrow, hopefully. That's the dismemberment bill, which would limit abortions in our state to 20 weeks instead of 24. So we really need that bill. And because babies can feel pain when they're larger, those are second trimester babies, and we just know through ultrasound and other ways that we need to protect those babies. The second thing is we want to show here, just mention our Lady of Guadalupe statue, since today is the feast day of Our Lady of Guadalupe, and it's probably over by now, but there was a wonderful, probably thousands of people filling the Santana arena there in Reading, where they had a huge mass today. It started at 6, so they're probably finishing right now, so you can't go. But next year, keep it in mind, December 12th, they have a mass 5 o'clock in the morning at St. Peter's, and then they have a large mass in the evening at Santander. Number three, I wanted to mention about the news article today, or not this week, that came out in the New England Journal of Medicine, very prestigious magazine, again warning women about the dangers of contraception and abortion and the connection to breast cancer. Anything that you take that's hormonal, abortion, it's changing the cycle. Same thing with birth control. Women need to know that there is a connection to breast cancer. Not all women will get breast cancer, but there is definitely a connection for some women, especially the African-American women. So if you get a chance, Google it, if you've got an internet, and you can read the articles on the internet. And then, excuse me, I want to just mention January 19th is the March for Life in Washington. This is a great, if you want to get enthused about the pro-life movement, that's the place to go. There are several buses running in Berks County from different churches. You can just call us and we'll let you know what buses are available. But encourage all of you to go. And if you're free, and next week, I mean next, yeah, the 6th, the 19th, Planned Parenthood, Reading Planned Parenthood, at 10:30 we're going to be singing Christmas carols. So those are my announcements. So I'll turn the program over to Carolyn and she can introduce our guests.
Okay, welcome to our program on abortion. We have two lovely people who have really stepped out in faith and adopted. Well, they'll tell you how many they adopted and all that's all those things. But this is going to be really special for people who have been thinking about adoption, some people who are adopted, and people who have adopted children. If you have any kind of questions and you have anything that you want to know that you've been thinking about, please call in. Our number is 610-378-0426, and that's probably be up on the screen. So just jump in anytime, and we'd be glad to take your calls. So let me have the honor of introducing both Sue and Tom Taylor. And we're all wondering, how did the two of you meet?
Well, we were both teachers, and we were working in Coatesville in a middle school. We met there in September of 1967. We dated for about 7 months, 8 months. We got engaged in June at the end of the school year, and then we were married in August of 68. The Lord had us stay in Downingtown for several years and also Coatesville, and then we moved up to Narbonne, Pennsylvania, and we spent about 32 years there in our home in Narbonne. And also, the Lord led us up to Twin Valley Bible Academy, where I was assistant principal for 3 years and principal for 30. And my wife, Sue, taught there after our children were all in school. She taught there and retired, 2010, 12?
So.
I retired in 2008. So that's how we came together. And we'll go from there.
Well, when did the, in this long history of being together, did you decide to adopt? And why adoption?
Well, we had been married for about 3 years, and we were talking about starting a family. And we decided that when we were growing up, church was an important part of our life. Yeah. And but we were sent to church. Our parents didn't go. So we thought that when we started our family, that we wanted to go to church as a family. And so we had gone to a little church not far from where we were living. And we were seriously thinking about starting a family. And unfortunately, I had two ectopic pregnancies, which left me unable to have our own children.
And that was dangerous for you, wasn't it?
Yes.
Kind of life-threatening.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. The Lord was good. So about 6 months after my second tubal pregnancy, my doctor had told us that the only way we would have a family is to adopt. And so we started a search and found out it was going to be a long wait through the agencies, and our doctor offered to put us on a waiting list that he had. And so one of his clients decided to give her baby up for adoption, and he called us and said if we would like to have that child, that we needed to call back the next day.
Now, did you ask, is this a boy or a girl? What race, what religion, what ethnicity? Did anything?
No. No, wow, sight unseen. Cute. The baby hadn't been born yet, and at that time, you still waited until the baby was born to know whether you were having a boy or a girl. Mm-hmm. And so, with no questions asked, we took that child, and we were very glad we did. That was our first adoption.
And how old was the baby when you...
4 days.
Oh, 4 days old.
Brought him home 4 days. Nice. Out of the hospital.
Mm-hmm. Now, in today's world, we understand that 1/3 of the newborns are addicted to opioids. Back then, it wasn't as prevalent, but was this anything that ever came into your mind? Is this child going to be autistic? Did you have any concerns at all? Did any of these things come into your equation?
No. We just trusted the Lord that, you know, when you have your own child, it's sight unseen. Mm-hmm. And when you have your own child, you take what the Lord sends you. What the Lord gives
that's
you.
That's a nice way to say
it. You know, and so we felt, you know, it wasn't any different than having our own child. Mm-hmm. So
what did you get?
Well, a little boy was born. We brought him home from the hospital when he was 4 days old. And I didn't have long to get ready for him. Our friends did throw a shower for us a couple weeks after we had the baby home. And I called my mother and asked her what I should do, and she always had these little sayings, and start from the inside out, so I did, with t-shirts and diapers. Went to my sister-in-law's, and she loaded our car up with a crib and stroller and everything we needed. And
you became a daddy.
Yes, I became a daddy pretty instantly. But the other thing is, I wanted to backtrack just a little. In December of 1972, I poured my heart out to the Lord, asked His forgiveness for my sins, and I received Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
Oh, that's beautiful.
And Sue did the same thing then in April of 1973, mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's when we first pursued getting a baby from the doctor. Hmm. And so Andy came along there, and we also had talked about foreign adoption. And so we worked with an agency. It was Holt Adoption Agency from Oregon. Harry Holt, I think it was a soldier in the Korean War. And he had a lot of compassion on the orphans and the young children that were running around. So they started an orphanage over there. And then he started bringing children back here to be adopted. And so we started in that process. We had to wait till Andy was a year old. in order to do that. But when Andy was a year old in February, we started that process, and actually we got Kim. Was it November we got Kim?
It
was
March.
March, okay, so that was after a year old. And we got Kim from Korea, and she was 6 months old when she came from Korea, flew in on a plane in New York. We drove up to get her and brought her home. And so she was the second one through.
How did Andy think about what did Andy think about all this? I mean, he was very, very little, but
he was very excited.
Was he?
Yeah,
he was.
Yes. And through their early years, he really loved Kim, and he was Kim's protector.
Oh, that's nice.
He didn't let anybody, you know, try to get rough
Big
with
brother.
Kim. Big brother, he was. And,
well, you had the perfect family. You had the boy and you had the girl.
Yes, we did. And I had always wanted three children. And one day Tom came home from school and he said, I think the Lord would have us have another child.
Ooh.
And my heart had been leaning that way as well and desiring to have that third child. And so he said, we'll call the agencies and see what we can do. And I called around and found out there was a long, long wait. We'll put your name on, Mrs. Taylor, but you know, you are the perfect family. You already have a boy and a girl. So we really felt that that's what the Lord would have us do as a third adoption. So we did pursue, kept calling around. And a friend of mine said, well, why don't you try the agency that we used out in York? And so we did. And the Lord sent us a three and a half year old boy, healthy, from Korea. And we adopted foreign adoption once, and we just thought that we would like to do that again. I always tell people, you know, if you're going to do foreign adoptions, do two.
That's nice.
But we got Andy, or Jimmy, through Tressler Lutheran Services, Children's Services, and again, he was 3.5 years old when we got him, so that's how we got the three and where we got them from.
And who picked the names? How did you?
Well, I had a friend that was a very strong witness to me when I was in Coatesville, telling me about the Lord. And his name was Andy. So we decided to name our oldest son Andy. Kim, her last name in Korean was Kim.
Oh.
Young-hee Kim. So we thought we'd call her Kimberly Ann Taylor.
And that's pretty. It sounds nice.
And then Jimmy, my brother's name was Jim. That was, I think, part of it. And we came with James Park Taylor. His last name in Korea was Korean was Park, so that's his middle name.
Do you have any pictures of your children?
Yeah.
Well, yes, we do. Actually, we have one family picture that has all of our children in the family picture. It's interesting because Sue's doctor told me after her second ectopic pregnancy, told me that you'll never have any children.
Oh my goodness, and look at the family. That.
And so from going to having never have any children, there's...
how many grandchildren?
Well, there's three children there, and there's two spouses, and then there's seven grandchildren, or seven and a half, because Jimmy's wife is pregnant there with their fifth child. So there's 15 of us now when we were not going to have any children at all. So the Lord has truly blessed us.
That's amazing. So. And how about the rest? You have a picture of your son's family?
A picture of our son's family, Jimmy and his wife Beth, and they have five children. So we have a picture of them. And there's Jimmy. Beth and their five children.
Oh my goodness.
And what a blessing they are to us.
Oh, I'll bet.
And now Kim.
They look like their daddy.
Kim, Kim, our daughter, is not married. She's a nurse in a local hospital. But then our oldest son, Andy, has three boys. And there's Andy with his three boys. And Andy's always been had a big interest in hunting And one of his boys here, Chance, is also a hunter, an archer. So they're very active there, very active. And we thank the Lord for all of them.
All right. Carolyn, you have statistics, too, to show.
Yes, I
do. Very
interesting. You know, I wanted to do a little bit on that, too, to see what other people do. And it's 59% of the children are found through foster care and through the welfare system. And that's how they get adopted. 26% come from other countries, like you have a couple from other countries. 15% are voluntarily relinquished by their parents. So you have like one and another in that category as well. And how did the children interact with each other?
Well, Kim and, of course, we don't look alike. You know, our family, we don't match. So it's obvious that we have adopted. And everyone wants to know if Kim and Jim are siblings. And they are siblings through adoption. And they consider each other brother and sister. Mm-hmm. And Kim has several nieces and nephews now. And they have their own families, which to me is just wonderful.
That is wonderful. That is wonderful.
It's their own families, and that's great.
I do have another chart, if we could get this chart up. It's the total about adoptions for 2016. There were 5,370 adoptions in that times period. And if you look at the split between the gender, it's almost, well, it's 49-51. It's almost 50-50 female and male that are adopted. So like you don't know, just like when you're having a baby, which way is it going to be. But the age groups were really what surprised me. I thought it was the little ones that were mostly adopted. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the chart.
That's what you would think, yeah.
Yeah, it looks like the 5 to 12-year-olds was the biggest number. That's where they are, most of them. And then the next one would be the 3 to 4 year olds, and then the 1 to 2 year olds. The under 1 year, like you had, was very unusual to get them that young. Then the teenagers, that's their difficult years.
Yes.
Then it kind of drops off. But maybe by then they've already been adopted. And then by the time they're 18 and older, it becomes very, you know, not that many. And if they are, they're not that welcome into people's homes when they're already older. So that was an interesting, thank you for putting that chart up. So my other question is, have you, what are the joys, what can you share with other people? Let me say the phone number again is 610-378-0426 if you have any questions for Sue and for Tom. But what were the joys that you had? What were the biggest joys, and how did your extended family accept everybody?
Our extended families, they all accepted the children very graciously. They love them. We've never had any problems with family members. And we can just say that we feel that they have brought us as much joy as whether they were natural children. We've never looked at them as any different from being natural children, because God picked them out especially for us. And so they have been such a blessing for us. They all live close to us, and so we see them quite often, which we are very grateful for also.
So do you have any words of wisdom for people who are considering adoption? So many people think about it, and then they get cold feet.
Well, I like to say that I've been adopted 3 times.
That's very good.
Yeah.
The children need to be loved. And I needed to be loved. And our children have just completed my life. And don't be afraid to reach out and to love a child and bring a child into your home. And it's a great feeling to know that it's reciprocated.
I just say go for it, because the children that are adopted can bring as much joy and blessing as natural children. And our children knew from whenever they could understand that they were adopted. Of course, as Kim said to me one time when she got a little older, Dad, I know I'm adopted. She says, you know, look at me and look at you. She said, so I know I'm adopted, but
can't keep it from her.
They have been such a blessing, and we again are so thankful to the Lord for them.
Mm-hmm. And you know, one time we were in a room with we had our two children at the time, and Tom's sister had adopted, and a friend of hers had adopted children.
Oh my gosh!
And there were seven children in the room, and out of those seven children, two were natural born, five were adopted.
Is that right?
Yes.
Wow. That's neat. That's neat to hear.
Well, I was also reading statistically that the adopted children have healthier lives.
Oh, really?
Yes. That when they're little, that the adoptive parents read to them more sometimes than their own natural-born parents do to them. Huh. And they're more engaged in activities than other ones. It just seems like they're like a little, they fell from heaven. And, you know, everybody's so happy to be together that sometimes that bond sometimes is even stronger.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. Mm-hmm. Well, you're certainly an example for, you know, expectant mothers who are facing unplanned pregnancies that, you know, it's for their own welfare that they, if they feel they honestly can't raise the child and be a responsible parent, to put their child up for adoption.
That's right.
And because there are, you're just one family, and there are thousands of families that would love to open their hearts and their homes
to
children. Mm-hmm. And here's just, we've had other people on the program too who have adopted, but it's always such a special story that, and it's all about love. It's just your love, you have love to give, and there are people that need that love, little children, and you get loved in return. So it's, you can't go wrong. What was the big, what about obstacles? What would you say was the biggest obstacle?
Well, there's always a time frame in between when you apply and you're anxious and you have to wait. Uh-huh. And then, of course, there's also the expense that's involved with adoptions. But we overcame those because the Lord wanted us to do this. And where the Lord guides, He provides. And so we never had any doubt about that. And so we didn't see any real big obstacles there. I wanted to say that Andy today is 43. He's in construction, a very hard worker, successful there.
He's the one that's the hunter?
He's the hunter, the oldest one. Kim's 42. She's a nurse in a local hospital. Also very successful. And Jimmy is our youngest. I think he's 36. Mm-hmm. And he's in financial planning, financial management, and also very successful. So, again, we think sometimes, where would these children be? Where would they be if they didn't come, you know, if God didn't give them to us?
Yes, we don't know where they were. You were telling me something about Jimmy. He was always an achiever.
Yes, he was. When he came at 3.5 years, he didn't speak any English. And 6 months later, he was speaking fluent, complete sentences.
Really?
Yes.
6 months?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And he was always good in business and selling whatever we were selling at school for fundraisers. He was top salesman. So we knew he would be in business.
Is he in sales?
He could sell you anything.
That's cute.
Well, do you have any really lighthearted story that you wanted to say? There was some particular funny thing or lighthearted thing that happened.
One thing, when we brought Jimmy home from the airport at 3.5, and we were coming down the New Jersey Turnpike, I guess it was, he was in the back behind me, and then all of a sudden I felt this brush combing what hair I had back here, and he was there combing my hair. And
isn't that sweet?
We stopped to get something to eat. We didn't know what he would like, but when he saw French fries, he dove into the French fries. And then also when we brought him home, he slept on the floor. We could not get him to sleep in a bed because at the orphanage, that's where he slept. And it took a while to get him to get adjusted to a bed. So,
was he healthy?
Very healthy.
Very healthy.
Very healthy. Yep. They all were. And so, anyhow, I don't know if Sue has any other.
Maybe he was afraid to fall out of the bed.
It might have been that.
You know, like, that's all for far down for a little 3.5-year-old.
Like sleeping on a table.
Yes. Oh, and he would hide his toys. Uh-oh. If he had a toy, see, he would hide it behind the sofa or the chairs. Because I guess, you know, in the orphanage, they didn't have
the
a lot of things to share.
Yeah.
The others would take it, so he would hide them behind.
And how about eating? Was he a good eater?
I think he was always a pretty good eater.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a big change in diet.
Yes.
From a foreign country. So, oh, my goodness. You guys are amazing.
Do you get any instruction when you're getting the children from a foreign country to help you maybe know some of their customs, or do you teach them their customs, or now that they're older, are they interested in that, or they just feel they're all American?
They're American. They're often asked, where were you born? You know, when did you come over here? Things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But they handle that pretty well.
They did send us some books that would tell us about their culture, a little bit about their language, you know, and some things that we could teach them. But it didn't take them long to pick up being an American.
Were they in the same school at the same time, like for high school at the same time? Because how close were they in age?
Well, Kimmon.
We have to end our show.
And we want to wish everyone
a Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
And we'll see you again in February.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay,
thanks for tuning in.
Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.